You're listening to the Wedding Biz Network, the voice of the creative entrepreneur. Hey everyone, it's Andy Kushner with The Wedding Biz, in which I conduct in-depth and revealing interviews of icons and those who I feel are the next generation icons of the weddings and event industry. And this is all to provide education and inspiration. And before I introduce today's special guests, I just want to say that now that we know that a vaccine is on its way, I am feeling hopeful. It is the first time I am really starting to feel the passion again for what I do. And knowing that all of us all over the world are really dealing with this together, with the impact on our businesses and our personal lives, at least, again, because of vaccine, the news of vaccines coming out, we know the end is in sight, but there's still several months left of challenges. So I just urge all of us to continue to reach out to each other, to give support. So anyhow, I want to mention that last week's episode, if you missed it, was the brilliant filmmaker Caleb Jordan Lee, who works worldwide. It was a really fun and interesting interview. And now, with no further ado, I'm so excited and honored to announce today's special guests, and that is Siwar and Majida Bisharat with My Event Design, based in Amman, Jordan, and working all over the world. I was introduced to them by Wendy El-Khoury, the founder of Wedded Wonderland, whom I interviewed in episode 252. My Event Design is a full-fledged luxury event design planning and management company founded by Majida Bisharat and her daughters Maysam and Siwar, covering events across the Middle East and Europe. In addition to weddings, engagements, corporate events, and other special events, My Event Design has designed and planned events for influential figures in various industries, as well as members of the royal family. And I had such a great time getting to know both of them. Enjoy my conversation with Siwar and Majida Bisharat. Hello, Majida and Siwar. So good to have you on the show. Welcome.
Thank you, Andy.
Hello, Andy. Thank you.
Yeah, this is going to be fun. And I want to thank Wendy El-Khoury from Wedded Wonderland for introducing us. Wendy was also on the show, and I'll put in the show notes the episode to listen to her interview. So I thank Wendy. So Majida, I would like to first start with you. I know that you founded the company. And from what I understand, I know that you studied fashion design and Italian in Italy. But where did you grow up? Was it in Jordan?
Yes, I was born and raised in Amman, Jordan, and my passion for what I do now started at a very young age.
Really? How old were you when you started to think about fashion design and all of this? How old?
And I guess maybe 10, 9, 8, while I was at school, I used to design dresses for my Barbie dolls while playing with them. The Barbie dolls.
Really? Wow.
Yeah, the Barbie dolls were like little mannequins to me. I also have passion to art and coloring. So I guess from there, I started thinking of being a fashion designer or studying fashion designing.
That's interesting. So when you studied fashion design, what did you do when you got out of school? What was the first thing that you did? Did you get a job right away?
Once I came back to Jordan, I had to plan my first fashion show to showcase my collection. So I planned it from A to Z by myself, and it was my first experience in planning. So direct after I came back from university, from Italy, Treviso, I did my first fashion show to showcase my collection.
You designed your own clothes, Majida? You designed the clothes?
Yes.
Wow. Okay, I didn't realize that. Okay.
Yeah. And it was difficult at that time in Amman because there weren't any fashion designer. And the idea amazed me that I will be the first fashion designer in Amman. And I was so excited about studying the fashion designer. So when I came back, I put on fashion shows in Amman, and I was the first fashion designer in Amman.
Wow. Now, was this in the late 70s? Is that right?
It is in the 80s, first of 80s.
Oh, the early 80s?
Yes, early 80s.
Because I understand that you also opened up a high-end boutique for designer clothes, now located at the Four Seasons Hotel Amman, Jordan. Is that right?
Yes, because after getting married and giving birth to my first daughter, I couldn't travel as much to get fabric and different materials. So I decided to open La Coquette, a high-end retail shop with the most famous fashion designers, to keep myself in the fashion industry, but in a different way. Let's say an easy way.
So why then how did you make the switch over to events, to designing for events? How did that transition happen?
Yeah, well, believe it or not, it all happened accidentally. While being a fashion designer, I always used to host parties and dinners at my home that I designed and styled, but I never thought of it professionally until a friend of mine approached me to plan her daughter's engagement party. I was scared but very excited for the challenge, as I wanted to give the guests a unique experience to remember. And since that event, I never looked back. So it was accidentally happened.
But how did you know how to even plan a party? I mean, had you done this before, or maybe perhaps you did it for yourself in your own home?
Yes, I did it for myself. I have passion for table setting, setting the buffet table, and always Christmas time, any occasion, always I have parties and dinners at my home. And by nature, I can't tell you that I learned it, but I have passion to play with the food, with the plates, with colors. So it's by nature.
Well, you know, it's interesting. When I first looked at all the event pics that are on the website and on the Instagram page, I could not believe how just absolutely stunning and beautiful they are.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're so welcome. And so, I understand that you continue to attend fashion weeks, isn't that right? In London, Milan, Paris, New York City, you travel to.
Yeah.
So, I understand, Majida, that in this industry, a lot of the designs for weddings come from the runway. Is that true from fashion? I mean, there's a direct correlation between the two.
Yes, I believe that. Actually, I took all my inspiration from my experience in fashion industry. Yes, even when I look back now, as you said, at my designs and at my events, I noticed that all my inspiration are verticals, inspired from the catwalk and the backdrop of the models and the seating, the theater seating style. I'm obsessed with that industry.
So you know, I know that we're in the pandemic and we'll talk about that later. But before the pandemic, you, from what I understand, you really love to travel and not only the fashion weeks, but just traveling is what inspires you. Is that right?
Yeah, everything around me inspired me. And it helped me a lot to create events, each event different than the others. Wherever I go, I have my sketch notebook and I called it my Bible, because at that time there wasn't the mobile and the telephone and all the technology. So we were sketching and writing everything in a small notebook. So yes, I took a lot of my inspiration from traveling, from interior design, fashion shows, concert, even music videos. And I'm obsessed so much with the Met Galas. I took a lot of inspirations from the Met Galas. Social media, such as Pinterest, Instagram, all beautiful things around me inspires me to create events, each one different than the other. And I believe, thanks to my past experience in my retail shop, I still get my inspiration from the fashion designer that I work with. For example, let me tell you something, that I learned how to love and use colors and prints from Matthew Williamson, Missoni, and Pucci, because I was selling that makes in my shop. And they are so good in colors, in prints, in everything. And sometimes you are scared mixing all these prints together. Then how to think out of the box from Moschino, and La Dolce Vita from Dolce Gabbana, and the sharp sculptural outline from Balmain. And I believe nothing beats the animal print of Roberto Cavalli. Although now everybody is doing the animal prints in different styles, but I think Roberto Cavalli, his print was the most one I liked. Also, I took inspiration from Dior, Bureau Pitat, Gucci, and so many others. They are great teachers for me and a solid base for my new career as an event designer and a wedding planner.
Hmm. Wow, that's really fascinating. And, you know, it's also when I hear you talk and especially about all the travel that you're doing and, you know, when I walk through the streets of Florence or Paris, I understand even the architecture is so inspiring to me.
Yes, you are right. Everything in Europe or any place in the world inspires me. Historical places, restaurants, hotels, lounges, wherever I go, it's an inspiration for me.
Mm. And Siwar, I want to turn to you and ask what it was like for you to grow up with your mother, with this, you know, with this love for everything that we've been talking about. I mean, I imagine that this is just kind of in your system as a young girl.
It is, Andy. Actually, I was born and raised in Amman, in Jordan, and I grew up in an environment where creativity was always encouraged. From art, music, to design and fashion, I was fortunate enough to always being exposed to the world of the arts through Majda, of course. And art plays a major role in my life.
And yet I understand that you got a bachelor's degree in information management for business in London. Is that right?
Yes, I got that. I graduated in 2011. And right after that, I began my career working for an oil and gas company, Royal Dutch Shell.
What do you feel that you learned from that experience that helps you now?
Well, honestly, it's really funny because I know like they're two different industries. We're like saying like from oil and gas to cakes and pink flowers.
That's right.
Yeah, that's a very drastic change. But, you know, my latest mission at Shell required me to bridge boundaries between the project engineering and the project management aspect of a project. So if you think about it, at the end of the day, an event is very similar to a project. There is a start date and there is an end date. But the only difference is that sometimes a project gets delayed, whereas in an event, the date cannot be delayed. With an event, the show must go on. But with projects, you know, you always get delayed. So yeah, my experience there really, really helped me a lot. It provided me with extensive managerial skills, along with the ability to envision long-term business development strategies for my event design.
Was your plan from the beginning, even when you decided what to do for college, was your plan it to join My Event Design at some point? Were you thinking about that?
Actually, no. I got a job offer, and I'm so happy I made this conscious decision to work for a multinational company prior to joining My Event Design, because I really wanted to gain experience from the real world. I wanted to learn and develop myself to really observe and understand, you know, the ins and the outs of a corporation. And if I had joined at the beginning, I wouldn't have brought anything major to the table. So even my father was very supportive of me to actually, you know, dive into the real world before joining My Event Design.
What did your father do, or what does he do?
He's into real estate, and we actually own an equestrian club. My family is so obsessed with horseback riding.
Oh.
So, yeah, he's into that.
Well, I imagine, I'm also thinking that, you know, to work with your mother, I mean, that's something I want to talk about, you know, a little bit later, but that I would think that you probably wanted to first establish yourself separate, right? Just as your own person by yourself. And so to be able to work, you know, in this other environment must have been important to you.
Very important, because really, like, I wanted, you know, I am where I am today because of my experiences, you know, and working with family is tricky because you need to really be able to separate, you know, like your working relationship from the bond of a mother and daughter. And it's much easier said than done. And I was worried at the beginning. So, I mean, after I made that decision to actually join My Event Design, we made an agreement to really put emotions out of it.
Really? But how did that conversation go for both of you? I mean, how do you approach that?
I mean, we argued at some point, and like we you know, we come from two different schools, different generations, and it's really nice because like I learn a lot from her, and I think she learns a lot from me. And after like several incidents, we decided like we really need to separate, you know, the working relationship from, you know, our bond. And you know, funny enough, I found it really helps when I call my mom by her name, Majid at work and mom at home. It automatically puts like this emotional barrier up. So that really helps.
Yeah, that is interesting. You know, you're making me think there's another mother-daughter team who I interviewed, Nikki Khan, Exquisite Events out of Los Angeles, California. And I remember it was a similar situation. And her daughter, who ended up later joining her, it was, you know, one of the advantages of it was that Nikki, the mother, was able to, you know, relate to the bride's mother in particular, whereas her daughter could relate to the bride. And it's a very powerful team.
That's absolutely right. I mean, like Majida always says that.
Yeah, I also noticed how strong of a team we are when we sit down with the clients. Usually the bride, the groom, and the mother of the groom are present. So we are speaking to two different generations. The bride or the groom always feels comfortable with Siwar because she's young and understands that generation a lot more. And the mother also feels at ease with me because she knows I'll understand the formalities and the requests that the bride might not think of as much. So, yes, it's a great team. It's a strong team, I believe, because it balances.
Well, and it's also, you know, it's so important, obviously, we all know, to stay relevant and to stay current and to be able to understand all the different generations. And so, you know, with our clients. And so I can see how, you know, again, it's just so attractive, I'm sure, to clients that they're able to have both of you sitting at the table with them.
Yeah, I think we make the perfect balance. I hope.
Yeah, well, so Siwar, what are your responsibilities versus your mother's? I mean, are they really separated? I imagine there's some overlap, or do you really have it separated out?
Well, to be honest, most of our roles and responsibilities overlap. But if I had to categorize it, I'd say, you know how like in my event design, we turn vision into reality. So Majida is in charge of the vision and I'm somehow in charge of the reality.
Okay, I love that how you say that. The reality, yeah.
I mean, yeah, because really our roles do overlap. And we try to separate as much as we can. But I'm also more on the business development side of the business. Mm. When before I joined my event design, it was a one-man show. It was literally Majda on her own. I don't know how. Like, she's a superwoman. I don't know how she managed to do it all. But, like, when I joined, I wanted to do so many things. And most importantly, I understood firsthand the passion and dedication my mother had for each and every client, and I wanted to take it internationally. And her vision really has no boundaries. So I thought to myself, why should we as a company? So I joined with full force.
Wow. So that's been a major responsibility for you, especially in the beginning, was to expand the reach of the company beyond Jordan.
Definitely. It was to expand the company, you know, like to reach it outside Jordan, which was very successful to us because I focused a lot on marketing, and social media is or was a big part of reaching clients and finding growth opportunities. Mm. I mean, it's funny how like Instagram is the marketing platform now.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. I want to be sure you know about another great show on the Wedding Biz Network, The Business of Being Creative, with host Sean Lowe. You've often heard Sean on my Next Level episodes. Well, now he's taking the creative business advice he shared with accomplished notables such as Preston Bailey, Vincente Wolf, Nate Berkus, Style Me Pretty, and Sylvia Weinstock, and more, and offering it to you on his new show. There are already a few episodes for you to catch up on where he discusses the power of being niched, pricing strategies, metrics of success, and so much more. So in short, you're going to gain a ton of value and action items from Sean's show, and you'll have the opportunity to talk back by recording messages of feedback from right there in the show notes. So if you are a creative who is turning your craft into a business or want to take it further, head to theweddingbiznetwork.com. And take a listen to The Business of Being Creative by Sean Lowe. Again, that's theweddingbiznetwork.com. I would love to hear, Majda, if you could tell me about your general process, starting with you, with when you first meet a wedding client and how that goes. You know, how is it that you start to come up with a vision, you know, from talking to them? What is the process?
The first thing, I try to understand their way in life, in lifestyle, in thinking. I try to understand what they like, what they don't like. It's very important, this part, to understand the client so I can talk to them their way, let's say. After the meetings with the client, I understand the team, what they want.
I just wanted to add something to Majda's point.
Sure.
The process that we go through at My Event Design is mainly like we have four main phases. The first step is my consultation, and then my research and design, and then my vendor curation and my execution. So during the first meeting with the client, which is my consultation and agreement, we get to know our clients more and, of course, see if we're a good match. The most important thing is we want to be familiar with the couple's story, with their personalities, with their style, ideas, and visions in order for us to bring more of their life into the big day. Mm. And it's really important for us to make sure that the wedding is a reflection of them. And then like we move on to the second stage, which is like the research part and the design. And here we create and share with our clients a very detailed, customized, aesthetically pleasing concept for the wedding space based on our meeting research. And it includes a lot of things such as like the set and scenery design, the installations, the guest entrance, the bridal entrance, the dance floor. And then we move on to the furniture and table. You know, what chairs, what show plates, what glassware, and then the floral design. So we provide them with like 2D plans and 3D floor plans and illustrations and sketches to help them visualize the space more.
Yeah, that's so wonderful that technology is getting to the point where we can, as a client, you know, we can really have such a better idea of what's possible.
Yeah, I mean, technology is amazing.
So can you both tell, or can, you know, one of you perhaps tell a story of one of your favorite events, just to help us understand, the process through an actual event?
Of course, Majda, do you want to say it?
Yes, I would love to. Yani, honestly, Andy, every event tell a story, and I'm in love with all my stories. However, I would have to say the event I'm most proud of was Siwar's engagement party.
Okay.
The theme party was called the Circus of Love, and it was a turning point for my event design for so many reasons that I will talk about. And Siwar, I'm sure she can tell later more about the theme, her vision, her inspiration, and so on. It was a great collaborative effort between me and my daughter that she was my client.
Okay.
The Circus of Love was a strong theme. It had all the strong decorative elements, from the big production to the huge installation and, of course, dramatic transformation of the space. There were so many customized experiences, and each experience told a story along the way through an amazing entertainment act. Here, I want to tell you something. Well, I said it's the turning point of my event design because it was the first time we used interactive entertainment. And we used so many singers, so many party bands. And I'm sure without the interactive entertainment, it wouldn't be the same, the event. The interactive entertainment upgraded the event. And from this part, I believe that we should use, and it was our turning point, that we make it sure that every event, we should have an interactive entertainment or any kind of entertainment to amuse the guests while they are in the wedding. And I'm sure you have an entertainment company, you know better.
That's right. Oh, I'm very well aware. One of the videos that I did watch ahead of time was of this, the Circus of Love. And I saw just the it was stunning. I mean, not only visually, but like you say, the interactive entertainment and how people, I can see it was an experiential kind of an event for them. They were such a part of it. I could see that.
Yes, certainly. It was also unusual for our guests or for Jordan. I mean, we've never executed an event of such caliber with so many entertainment and, you know, like we had like emotional catering, we had entertainment for to welcome the guests. So it was like the entire unique experience that made this event very popular.
Wow. What are some of the, I imagine your events, again, I looked at so many pictures on Instagram and the website, they're so intricate as well in order to do what you do at such a high luxury level. The challenges must be incredible and that you've run into. Can you perhaps tell me a story of one of the most difficult challenges you've ever had at an event and how you handled it?
There is a lot of challenges in each event. But for me, those challenges are like lessons that I learned a lot about those experiences. But it is important, I think, what I learned from my first event, let's say, that each event has so many elements and so many suppliers that are working together to make the event happen. But I believe it's very important to make it clear for those suppliers, like the production company, the executing suppliers, the florists, and the rentals, that they are working under your umbrella as one team. And that without your design and creative idea will not be any production or any execution. And to remember that you are the event designer. Andy, why I'm saying that? Because in so many events, let's say, I have the idea, I have the design, everything is ready. And the production company, they misunderstood sometimes that they are the event designer. So because they did a nice production, let's say, or maybe the florist, because she did a nice arrangement, they thought that they did this event. So it's good from the beginning to make it clear and to understand that and to respect each other's zone, and that there is so many parties in this event to make it happen. And we should work all of us as one team under one umbrella. And other than that, other challenges, I don't remember. Most of the events went smoothly, let's say.
So obviously ahead of time, you're planning for all kinds of possibilities that might happen.
Yeah, for sure.
I know too that you all have a showroom and a shop located in a very prominent neighborhood, which features luxurious home decor and accessories. Can you tell me about that? That's interesting that you have that.
Yeah, I have passion and since long time, the same time as my passion for event design, fashion design, I have passion for home interior decor. And as soon as I thought of opening my event design, since I'm going all the time to Milan Design Week and to Maison et Objet, and always I got my inspiration from there, and I like so many items. So the idea, I got it from there, that I do orders to my shop, and at the same time, I can use it for luxurious event if needed. So from there, I got this idea to open this retail shop for home decor accessories. Let's say small items, not sofas or dining table, just decorative items and some ottomans and a few small items. I have passion for home interior decor. If I wouldn't be an event designer, I would be an interior home decorator.
Ah, do you do some of that? Do you do some interior design for people?
Yeah, in the past, I did a few small projects for my friends. And now, during the COVID, I decided to move my current office to a new one at my garden. I practiced my passion to interior home decor, and I started a small project from the scratch. It has been consuming my time and my mind since 4 months, and I'm enjoying every single step. And this is what I mean about never stop learning. Because although I didn't study yet, but all the time, I keep learning myself, researching, watching the trends at YouTube, at Pinterest. And I think I'm good.
No, she's really good. Andy, when you come and visit us, hopefully soon in Jordan, you'll be able to see the new office.
Oh, I would love to. Listen, and I'm going to be a little bit bold and say, I would love to see your home. The home must be absolutely stunning. I can imagine.
You will love it. It was established 1924.
Wow.
Can you imagine?
Yeah, it's one of the oldest houses here in Jordan.
Wow. I imagine the interior design is must be absolutely stunning. What about also, I understand you all offer personalized branding consultation. Is that right? Do I have that right? You offer that service?
Actually, we used to offer that service. Now it's integrated. We used to offer it separately, but now it is integrated within our scope of work. So let's say when a client comes to us, we are in charge of the personalized branding. So let's say the logo of the couple, we work on it. We also work on like the design, because we believe personalization is so important. So from like the prints of the dance floor to the logo, you know, we have to try and make everything so unified and consistent. So even like with the website, the itineraries, we try our best to have a personalized branding for these couple.
You know, let's also talk about COVID right now, the pandemic. I mean, this hit us all over the world, in especially March. By March, it was everywhere. I mean, I imagine you're going through the same thing, you know, that we all go through, where so many events had to be postponed and canceled. How are you dealing with that? How has it, first of all, how has it affected your business and how are you dealing with it?
Other than spending and not earning,
yeah.
For me, the pandemic was a great break. I had enough time to think and to value myself and my event design, to refresh and set plans towards the new normal. Other than going back to my exercise, cooking, working on my English language, we as my event design, and during COVID, we were requested for an Instagram challenge to design a table escape using the materials at our home during our quarantine. We were so excited to work on this simple project, yet so creative challenge. We loved this idea, and every week we were challenging ourselves by doing different themes and styles of table setting and shared with our followers at the social media. We challenged our team to create boards and different themes. When the market of micro weddings and intimate celebration are opened, we had a few requests that we were prepared well for the new normal.
And I can also add to that and say, like, in our country, the situation is getting worse, much worse than when the outbreak was at its peak. I mean, we're going back to a full lockdown tomorrow, actually.
Oh, wow.
And at first, when the pandemic happened, we were in denial, just like I believe most of the people in our industry.
Sure.
But then when things got real and I realized that our industry would be the last to operate, Majida and myself decided to look at it from a different perspective, from a positive perspective, actually. And this was an opportunity to think about new revenue streams for our business, find new ways to generate savings, and, you know, come up with new ways to adapt to the changing needs of our clients. And a lot of positive things came out of this. We had to add another branch under the My umbrella, and we came up with a concept called My Tablescape. We're really excited about this project. We're going to be launching end of November because it's designed as a luxurious rental service which supplies do-it-yourself themed table setting kits delivered to a client's doorstep.
Mm.
And this service aims to give you a modern twist on hosting. We want our clients' hosting experience to be chic, fun, effortless, and easy, because in this day and age, everyone deserves it.
Yeah. What a wonderful idea. And I love what you're saying, that you used this downtime in order to come up, you know, with a new idea. Like you said, another stream of revenue. I think that's brilliant. If I understand correctly, do you also have an entertainment company called My Entertainment? Is that true?
Yeah, we have. We have an entertainment company called My Entertainment. I expanded it in 2016. My passion for entertainment started when I was 7 years old. I used to sing, dance, and act at school. I always loved going to shows, the theater, and places to enjoy live music. And I've always had a thing for the world of performing arts, actually. I wanted to major in it at some point. But yeah, I mean, to me, diversification is key. We like to think big. We don't limit ourselves to be good enough for Jordan or in Jordan. We want to be good enough for the world. So my entertainment came about in 2016. And it's a talent booking agency or an entertainment booking agency.
So, you know, also I know that, is it both of you who speak at wedding conferences? I believe you both speak. Is that right?
Yes.
Yep. It's Majda and myself.
What do you talk about? What kind of topics?
We talk a lot about the new trends.
We also talk about luxury. What is luxury and what is luxury in our culture? We talk a bit about the Jordan, the trends, and how we like to transform the space, the tunnels. A lot of people request Majda to talk about her signature style.
Yeah, I imagine so. Well, you know, before we end this conversation, I want to ask, what do you both think the event world is going to look like when this pandemic is over? You know, I believe that we've sped up time by many, many, many years. I mean, we're making better use of technology because of this situation. Now there's more interest in, like you were saying earlier, micro weddings, things like that. But overall, how do you feel the event industry? What is it going to look like when we come back?
I personally believe by June next year, things will go back to normal, or at least the new normal.
Yeah.
There will be a few trends that COVID forced us to try that will stay with us. I mean, especially in our culture, for example, like greetings in our culture, people greet with passion. They hug and they kiss on the cheek.
Yeah.
Like twice, if not seven times.
I mean,
but part of our culture and tradition is for the parents of the groom and bride to meet and greet all attendees. And that like literally takes an hour from the reception. So that will definitely, you know, stop. I also feel like most of our weddings are 700 pax minimum. So they might become 400 attendees instead of 700. Buffet versus seated dinners and like paperless invites. You know, in our culture, doing paperless invites is not a big thing. It's always like a hard invite. So we will see some changes. But when it comes to design, maybe Majda, you can add some points.
Yeah, Majda, what do you think?
I think the people, they like the idea of the micro weddings and the intimate celebration. And I think that it will not be like before with 1,000 guests or 700 guests. And I feel that people, they are enjoying those intimate weddings and celebration because they can control it. They can talk to each other instead of wasting their time saying hi, hello. They are enjoying, really, they are enjoying the wedding itself. So I think it will not go big as before. I think production and other things will be all minimalized. I'm not sure. Yeah, I'm confused.
Yeah.
Sometimes I think people will go crazy. They want bold things, big production, flowers. They want to replace what they missed past year. But at the same time, I feel that people still love the micro wedding and the intimate celebration, and they will continue on in smaller base, I believe.
Yeah.
And it's confusing.
It is. You know, I know it's not clear yet it's going to be very interesting. It's really going to be interesting to see what happens. And I think it's going to be gradual. You know, I think they can't wait to get back to partying. But at the same time, I think there's going to be some hesitance.
What I think is like human beings have a very short memory.
Hmm.
So
interesting.
I mean, like if you give it some time.
Yeah.
They will go crazy.
Yeah, no. Things will go. They will go back to normal.
Well, I hope so. I hope as soon as possible. And I hope people do go crazy with events. I hope it happens.
Yeah. Me too. And with entertainment, Andy.
Yeah, I'm here.
We can't wait to have you here. We can't wait to collaborate on an event together.
I would love that. I would absolutely love that. Well, this has been such a pleasure and an honor. I really, really enjoyed this with both of you. I mean, thank you so much for coming on to the show.
Thank you for you.
Thank you for having us. It's truly a pleasure to be on your show.
So welcome. So welcome.
Yes, it is a great, great pleasure, Andy, really.
Thank you for saying that. Thank you. Thank you for listening to my conversation with Siwar and Majda Besharat. Be sure to check out their website, which is my-eventdesign.com. Again, my-eventdesign.com. Their social media handle on Instagram is myeventdesign. And there are more handles on various other social media platforms, which can be found in the show notes at our website of theweddingbiz.com. So be sure to go there to find that out. And please share this episode with your friends and colleagues so that they can also find out about the show. And don't forget to listen to our follow-on segment, which comes out every Wednesday, called The Next Level, in which I have a guest co-host, and together we tease out some of the highlights of the interview in order to provide tips and advice for you to use to bring your own business to the next level. And this week's guest co-host is going to be founder and editor-in-chief of Destination I Do magazine, Jennifer Stein, who has been a frequent contributor to the show. And I want to mention next week's interview, and that is going to be with Alex Fitzgibbons, managing director of Fait Accompli out of London, who plans and designs spectacular events worldwide, including A-list and royal weddings. And so we'll catch you next week on The Wedding Biz.